My name's Rob Fennell, and I'm a faculty member here at Atlantic School of Theology, and I'm also director of Camino Nova Scotia. If you'd like to learn a little bit more about Camino Nova Scotia, there's a little handout for you to pick up at the back on your way out. Now, folks, who is here on our campus for the first time today or last night? Who's new to our campus? We're really glad you found us. We're kind of tucked away here, so it's really a pleasure. And nice to see folks from all kinds of places in our community here today. We're especially delighted to be welcoming Dr. Bill Schmidt, who is our Nicolson lecturer for 2015. Bill is a professor at Loyola University in Chicago and the Institute of Pastoral Studies there. And I know that you're going to find his talk engaging and thought-provoking as he integrates pastoral and professional and personal and scholarly interests on this theme of pilgrimage this afternoon. The Nicolson Lectures were established in memory of a former principal of Pine Hill Divinity Hall, which is one of the founding institutions of AST. He was principal here from 1946 to 1971, and everyone called him Big Nick. I think it's because he was tall. The endowment fund that was set up in Nicolson's memory enables us to offer the lectures here, thanks to Pine Hill Divinity Hall and its continuing interest in the lectures. But there's also an opportunity to contribute to the lectureship series that we have here at AST, and that's also on the back table if you'd like to do that. So again, warm welcome, Bill. After his talk, we're going to have some time for discussion and questions, I think.
Yes.
And I think you're all going to be really blessed by Bill's talk today.
Thank you. Thank you for being here. You're serving up a nice variety of weather conditions for me, so I appreciate that. And it's really been rich for me to be here thus far already, and I look forward to this further opportunity to pursue this wonderful topic. Yesterday, I essentially focused on ourselves as the primary pilgrims. It was focused more on our human journeys, within which we experience God's participation. And today we're going to focus a little bit differently on the Holy Spirit on pilgrimage, for which we can also be accompany that process. So the shift is going to be very different today, but I hope you will find this enriching and meaningful. I'm shifting my focus significantly from yesterday, when pilgrimage was presented as a process that we undergo as we embark on our transformational journeys. I describe pilgrimage as a journey to the center, but I need to make the case today as to whether Sacred Spirit also serves that process in particular ways. Is Spirit central to the process at all? And if so, in what way? Our age is hungry for Spirit awareness and yearns for traces of Spirit to rekindle our lives and fill the empty spaces of our being. If the predominant ills of earlier eras were informed primarily by guilt and condemnation dynamics, then the salvation offered attempted to save us from that fate. I would propose that we suffer in some different ways. Our age is the age of emptiness and a desire for authentic expressions of meaning and purpose. If theology is to be the story of God, then that story of God meets us where we are. It also meets us in the story of God today, as God's own Spirit story. Holy Spirit, too, is on pilgrimage, and we are privileged today to accompany this Spirit. I want to explore Holy Spirit's story today and do so in three ways. First of all, historically. Secondly, theologically, in Trinitarian mode. And finally, ministerially, as a call to ministry and accompanying Spirit's work. The bulk of my comments today will not be as explicit about pilgrimage as yesterday, since I unpacked the human parameters of pilgrimage as our journeys to the center of our lives, from decenteredness to re-centeredness. My incarnational vantage point tells me that God and Jesus wanted maximum exposure to God's children, even to the point of being rejected and even killed. God in Jesus radically decentered himself to be with us. I now want to claim the same incarnational path for God as Spirit, namely as an ongoing incarnation. I hope we will find traces of such a deep and abiding affinity with us as Spirit. The risk I am taking is that I am seemingly trying to speak for God. And don't you think we've had too many religious leaders trying to speak for God and God's Spirit? But I'll take that chance today. One of the operative spirit metaphors that we are familiar with is wind. As you know, Jesus also offered us this analogy and reminds us that we don't really know where Spirit comes from and where it is going. But that does not mean that Spirit is random or non-discernible. What I can say with confidence is that we will be met by Spirit in all of our searching and in the midst of all of our ambiguities. Our world is buffeted by splits. Splits is my alternative word for dualisms, of flatland, of massive reductionism at personal, social, political, and communal levels. We, who are on the Emmaus Road, have the Jesus narrative to support us along the way, but it's also a rough road with sometimes confusing road signs, even dead ends, where we must backtrack to find the path that seems passable. Because we, as Emmaus walkers, are also asked to be advance agents for Pentecost and the spirit awakenings that we will need to undergo as we are in our way, these stirrings of the Spirit need to be understood, taken seriously, and trusted to ultimately guide us in the uncertainties ahead. No serious journey is undertaken without checking the lay of the land. Our lay of the land is not particularly pretty. There are strong headwinds to be expected, and probably some major storms along the way, such as here in Halifax. The stops for refreshment are not necessarily guaranteed, and accommodations will be spotty at best. There will be zealots along the way who will ridicule us and think us freaks, perhaps, but if we are lucky, they will perhaps only laugh at us. But the biggest challenge of all that we might encounter perhaps might be internal, because none of us are ever fully prepared for what lies ahead. We know in ourselves we do not have everything we need, and so we will be tested in ways that we perhaps cannot imagine. Will we perhaps lose trust in the journey itself? And yet, Pentecost beckons. One such critical headwind we will face is the erosion of God awareness in our world. On the one hand, God seems ever more remote, an artifact for many, a relic, perhaps quietly held, but largely irrelevant and certainly not determinative for life purpose or meaning. On the other hand, we will be buffeted by absolutism, the absolutisms of fundamentalism, of rigid literalism, of objectification, whether scientific materialism or neurological reductionism and so forth. But above all, the erosion of coherent meaning, systems of meaning. We will suffer a glut of dualisms. This is not a new problem. We can find continuous dualistic models, structures, beliefs throughout history, perhaps begging the question that our world serves up dualisms as an inevitable byproduct of human existence. But there is another consistent hint that the universe has an integrating, unifying force, which operates discreetly, perhaps under the surface, but visible through the profound eruptions into human experience, into history, and into the very fabric of life. This hint is already embedded in the Pentecost narrative. The biblical record itself leads the way to our gaining an appreciation of this work. I call this work Sacred Spirit, and is embedded in and appears out of human experience. The prophetic tradition profoundly reveals such spirit awakenings in their states of bondage, of fragmentation, and their yearnings for liberation. The Spirit gives voice to transformational possibilities, which gives birth to the vision that guides our way forward. The biblical record consistently suggests that Holy Spirit leads the way, and that theological insights follow, not the other way around. Our experience of Spirit awakens us to the unanswered questions and unrealized meanings that reside within our questioning. thus becoming a living spirituality. But a quick caution is in order. The sacred spirit is not an object of our inquiry, as we might study an object in the human or physical sciences, as if spirit were a target of our examination. It is rather we who are being investigated. 1 Corinthians 2:10 tells us, the Spirit searches all things, even the depths of God. The biblical record is our first necessary guide in this exploration. The Bible uses key central metaphors to inform us about the various manifestations of spirit, and they include the following, as you see, first of all, here on the slide. Breath is very familiar to all of us, that which animates life, healing wind, purgative fire, living water, the narratives of the cloud, the dove at baptism, and perhaps most preciously, in my estimation, the paraclete, the one who is with us forever. Because I'm using Pentecost as my prime window into our spirit explorations, I need to reflect briefly on the Spirit's presence at Pentecost as central to the birth of the church. The Pentecost Spirit event has sometimes been called the organizational moment of the church. It certainly has been held up as a profoundly symbolizing the unitive vision for the church, but perhaps less so, maybe more problematically, its diversity elements. I find it instructive to consider the parallels between the Tower of Babel and Pentecost. In the former, there are seeds of disarray and non-comprehension destructively visible, leading to distrust, disintegration, and chaos. At Pentecost, on the other hand, there's also non-comprehension, a non-relying on content within the speaking in tongues experience. Rationality or reason is not central at Pentecost, and yet chaos doesn't reign, and a higher unity nevertheless becomes visible. But all is not so clear-cut at the birth of Pentecost. Even in its first transformative moments, however, there was a dispute over the meaning of the speaking in tongues element. The factor of inspired speech reveals a significant first fault line, which has continued to trouble the Christian community with the seemingly old yet completely contemporary questions surrounding sacred spirit. This first fault line, among other things, serves as a critique of the heavy reliance on reason or rationality as a source of spirit awakening or animation versus an invitation to trust the more non-rational, or better said, the trans-rational and transformative elements. The emergence of charisms, in other words, spiritual gifts, seems to be a central manifestation of spirit and are predominantly visible in the prophetic tradition. It is most noteworthy that when these spirit manifestations do appear, they are not given hierarchically, but are expressions of transformative multiplicity. Yet there seems to be an inherent mistrust of the so-called spiritual gifts at the first Pentecost. Peter, for instance, rushes to the defense of the Pentecost participants, stating, "These people are not drunk," and then affirms the profound message of the prophet Joel, which we had so beautifully read yesterday in Scripture. While the Christian community had as its core unifying narrative the Jesus event, tension soon emerged around the core doctrinal affirmation, such as Jesus' divinity, but increasingly about the role of experience itself. How do we know if the Spirit of Christ is still active if we have no current, overt, visible manifestations? Where are the signs and wonders, or at least the reliable markers of God's presence, if not in their charismatic form? Certainly, in the first century, Holy Spirit is affirmed as a central manifestation of God's life. Yet challenges came quickly enough in the form of the Montanists. They affirmed the charismatic and enthusiastic side of awakening and transformation, but began to challenge emerging ecclesial structures as well as questions around the nature of revelation. The Montanist insistence on spiritual gifts and prophetic utterances caused their critics to conclude that they favored ecstasy, or kind of out of controlness, and therefore loss of control of one's faculties. The challenges they pose for the church clustered around the nature of experience versus doctrinal affirmations, as well as the nature of revelation. Is revelation fixed and immutable, or is it progressive? How determinative is Scripture in determining so-called truth versus falsity? And how do we assess the legitimacy of spiritual gifts? The entire patristic period is full of richly layered conflictual struggles around these questions. It is beyond the scope of our efforts today to entertain these questions other than to linger briefly in the profound impact of Augustine. Augustine is the first great systematizer of the Holy Spirit for Western Christendom. His gift was to shift attention away from abstract ideological pursuits in the pursuit of knowledge and shift us toward love as the final criterion for the presence of sacred spirit. His proof is 1 John 4:16. God is love, and the one who abides in love abides in God, and God abides in him. There is no fear in love, but perfected love casts out fear because fear involves punishment, and the one who fears is not perfected in love. We love because he first loved us. It is perhaps a great irony that as sublime as these affirmations may be, it's a commonly held belief that Augustine, in his broader affirmations, closed off further transformative awareness for Western reflections and conclusions on the Holy Spirit. Western thought, it seems, became very preoccupied with guilt and redemption theologies, a kind of a forensic approach to the salvation question, thereby increasingly removing the life of faith from direct experience and from a lived spirituality. The wonderful work of Catherine Lacuna in God for Us is a rich resource here, and I don't have the time to actually dwell into that, but I want to point that out as an important element in our reflections. Even though Augustine's love as spirit is a significant marker, it removes spirit from our raw lived experience, thereby seemingly leaving us with a renewed dualism. If this conclusion became so problematic for Western thought, where then do we look for dynamic living spirit narratives within our Western mode to help us build a bridge to the guidance we are seeking in the modern era? I propose that the bridge we are seeking is found in our Western mystical tradition. The mystics reveal a powerful and vigorous affirmation of spirit and presents us with fresh but profoundly grounded manifestations of sacred spirit. There are many such sources we could find in this effort. Bernard of Clairvaux, Jakob Böhm, Meister Eckhart, Catherine of Siena, Julian of Norwich, and the list goes on and on. I will select only two, based on their explicit contemporary relevance, and will begin with Hildegard of Bingen. This visionary woman, theologian, composer, medical researcher, preacher, and the first woman doctor of the church, in her reference to Pentecost, she sees the Spirit bathing the participants with the fire of the Holy Spirit, allowing them to lose their fear and timidity in the service of God's truth. She herself lived this out through her confronting kings and popes and empires and the power centers of her day. Most profoundly, however, at least for our modern vantage point, she links the Holy Spirit to a term she calls greening, which for her means the earth is infused with spirit through watering, planting, fertilizing of the earth as a manifestation of spirit. The flow of water onto crops is akin for her to the love of God, which renews the earth but also renews the soul of God's people. This spirit mode for Hildegard is the activity of fertility, of enlivening, and additionally directs us to virtue, a prime gift of the Spirit. A century after Hildegard, we come across the figure of Bonaventure, whose vision of Spirit as magnanimous God as Spirit manifesting self-diffusing goodness. He uses the term bountiful goodness over 240 times in his writings, declaring that God's givingness is visible in incarnation. In sending of Spirit, God provides an endless flow of gifts and blessings. God's Spirit is the ever-flowing, self-giving fountain of all fullness. Like Hildegard, He uses nature imagery to express sacred spirit as a living water flowing, gushing, bubbling, as a source of eternal living spirit. The human, the earth itself, are a mode of God's life. The spirit-giving is not exotic or extraordinary, but permeates all that is. The Reformation emerges as a watershed in our spirit explorations. In its most broadly perceived analysis, we generally hold to a discontinuity between the classic Roman Catholic view, which emphasizes a continuity between God's grace, God's spirit, i.e. grace, and human nature and human spirit. We generally conclude that most reformers diverged from the Roman Catholic view and that they held to a discontinuity between nature and grace, generally argued around the nature of salvation. In other words, faith must be perceived as a gift of God and not claimed in any way through one's own personal capacity. What is overlooked in this one-dimensional conclusion, however, is that there was an alternative subtext, especially from within the so-called left wing of the Reformation, as represented by the Anabaptists and their successors. The Anabaptists had a very particular take on the relationship between Holy Spirit and the Word of God visible in Scripture. Yes, they believed obedience to the Word was normative, but on so doing, they elevated Holy Spirit as a supreme interpreter or guider of that Word. The Spirit, in infusing the Word, gives the Bible its vital centrality. But more importantly, they made a vital distinction between the inner and the outer Word. The inner Word must, of course, be read, but to truly be understood, it must be personally appropriated, and that can only be interpreted by Spirit. This direct infusion of Spirit-given awareness is individually received without an intermediary. It can be directly given to the heart of the inner life of the believer. This awakening to interiority has profound continuing effects in our understanding of person, of community, and on patterns and processes of individual and communal identity. We now have been affirmed to seek direct, immediate access to God with a close and virtually non-existent distinction between the inner light of consciousness and the Holy Spirit. As vehemently as he critiqued the Anabaptists for this perspective, Luther himself moved in these directions in his strong incarnational perspective, which is closely linked to the gifts and work of the Spirit. Creation, he says, cannot sustain itself. And with his lovely Lutheran earthiness, he references Genesis by comparing the Spirit to a chicken who sits on the eggs to make them hatch. So I leave this with my first profound metaphor. If you leave here with one insight, you could say this: the Holy Spirit is like a chicken. All right? Very, very important point. Don't forget that. Luther additionally provides us with a rich depiction of Holy Spirit's operations, including, of course, sanctification and the process of moving toward holiness, but also includes differentiation, allowing for discernment of spirits in the cosmos. Discernment, too, is a gift of consciousness, that gift of Spirit bringing guidance to our choices and to our human activities, thus allowing for a fuller and more intentional life. Luther calls this Spirit giver of life, love, manifested in and through benevolence and goodness in relation to human beings. Now, in jumping ahead about 200 years to the beginning of the Enlightenment, we arrive at another marker of tension, a fault line that in many ways is a tectonic plate that shifts and moves very much even in our day. The late Middle Ages increasingly held to metaphysical approaches to God, the result being God and the world were ever more separated. Into this fundamental question emerged the towering figures in the Enlightenment of people like Hegel and Kant and so on. Now, it's probably going to be a great relief to you that I'm not going to launch into Hegel and Kant, okay? We could do that. It would be very helpful, but we're not going to do that. So we're going to move on to the 20th century very quickly. We're jumping ahead very fast here now. The fault line of transcendence immanence and its subset of supernatural versus natural has remained a significant, a significant source of friction and non-resolution for us. The 20th century, however, did provide some profound theological voices with regard to these questions. And I will offer some insights from the key contributors in the 20th century in order to gain some greater clarity and confidence as we move to address the fundamental questions of our day. Now, as you look at this list, there are eight people on here, the top four are all German. And when I looked at it, I thought, there are too many Germans on this list. So I'm going to lop off a couple of them, so I'll certainly have to address Rahner. I teach at a Jesuit university, and Karl Rahner is a Jesuit. I can't ignore Rahner, so we're going to certainly address Rahner, but we'll skip through a few of the others. Okay, so we begin our contribution, we want to look at the contribution now of Karl Rahner. The challenge he sets for himself is formidable. On the one hand, Rahner wants to affirm the universal saving work of sacred spirit, and at the same time reaffirming the necessity of supernatural revelation and faith. His path for this resolution is his affirmation that God reveals God's self to every human being in every experience of that person's own finite life, and does so within every person's open transcendence. God, he claims, is the holy mystery, who is the ground and horizon of our full human subjectivity. His so-called transcendental method affirms that human beings are naturally inclined to the mystery we call God. Because human beings are spirit, we are open and therefore have a receptivity to spirit. Transcendent experiences reveal our natural inclination for such mystery, to awe, to wonder, and to our core experience of being met. Because God makes God's self available, God's self-communication means that God makes our very own self the innermost constituent of our own nature, i.e. our personhood. This is the sacred mystery of spirit for Rahner, that God is communicating God's self in and through God's Holy Spirit, always and everywhere, in every person's innermost center of existence. This experience of God and self is not individualistic or solipsistic. It rather exists in relation to others. At its most basic level, our encounters with others in human relatedness is intimately related with our encounter with God. Human transcendence in love, i.e. relatedness, is only possible for Rahner because of God's self-communication of God in spirit. So history now becomes our lens with this vantage point. In our contemporary global world, we most urgently need to ask how the universality of spirit is present universally. Rahner's answer is that it is the spirit who facilitates the human reception to divine grace and the personal movements of transcendence. Transcendent experiences nudge us toward an explicit awareness of such reality. But how then are we to engage alternative truth claims and perhaps even welcome them? Rahner gives high respect to other religious traditions and affirms that all religions have experienced individual moments of transcendental awareness, and in their lofty forms, therefore, reach their final form in an implicit Christ-likeness, as he calls it. He calls such persons anonymous Christians and suggests that because of human sin, all of our partial appropriations of revelation are always mixed with some element of error or incompletion. But there is, he says, nevertheless, spiritual value in any religious mediation of spirit, even where it is imperfect. Thus, he says, potentially all religious traditions express aspects of God's self-expression and are part of the history of revelation. He says, this does not make them all equal, but through the notion of the mystical body of Christ, he holds that there is a state of implicit faith even prior to hearing of the gospel, an invitation that invites persons to respond positively to any grace. Receptivity to grace, even in its implicit form, is a manifestation of spirit. Now, we may want to ask the question of ourselves, is his notion of universality, as he packages it, adequate for today? I'm going to skip our friend Moltmann. I hope he forgives me, but Pannenberg, and I'm going to just linger very briefly, 2 minutes, on Moltmann. In a 1992 book, Moltmann says the following: in both Protestant and Catholic theology and devotion, there is a tendency to view the Holy Spirit solely as the Spirit of redemption. Its place is the Church, and it gives men and women the assurance of their eternal blessedness of their souls. Now, I interrupt my little quote here from Moltmann to give you a little story. For various reasons, I'm not able to type with this hand, so I dictate everything. When I reread this after having dictated it, the last sentence, "the eternal blessedness of our souls," came out, "the turmoil blasted mess of our souls." And I was going to erase it, and I thought, this really makes sense. I can relate to that more than what I just read from Moltmann. So I've left it in here, okay? It's part of the text now. And if you can relate to that, as I do, just keep it in the text. All right. The turmoil blasted mess of our souls. What he was trying to say was, this redemptive spirit, which when it's cut off from bodily life and the life in nature, it makes people turn away from this world and hope for a better world beyond. They then are seeking experiences in the Spirit of Christ in a power that is very different from one's own essential lived experience. Moltmann's analysis that there are tragic consequences of this splitting spirit from life and the world and creation. Furthermore, he says, the Spirit of Christ and God's Spirit in history are artificially separated from one another. Moltmann's remedy is to allow both transcendence and immanence to mutually reinforce one another without contradiction. They're two complementary aspects of one dynamic. Historically, we have tended to drift into either pantheistic reductionism or a one-sided transcendentalism. We must, however, he says, think triadically by mediating between the so-called world beyond and as we live in the world of the now. We do this, he says, by tracking the forward moving elements of life in its lived process. This forward movement allows us to perceive the time element and the irreplaceability of every event. We can begin to perceive the temporal flow of life, which vibrates between transcendence and immanence, and their connection becomes visible as a living way, a way which unfolds in the network of life's relationships. This awakens us to an ecological vibrancy, a rediscovery of the body, of sexuality, and of the political structures that impact the flow of life. I'm moving on to Michael Welker, and Michael Welker is actually my favorite and most beloved resource in this way, so bear with me for a few extra minutes as I give you a flavor of Michael Welker. His great book is called God the Spirit. In turning to Michael Welker, we find his prime question to be a very formidable one, which is, where is the Spirit of God? His answer quickly surprises us, first by challenging some of the uncritical historical equations in which spirit is simply equated with life. He is very critical of generalizations, where distinctions between spirit and spirits are not distinguished. Secondly, Welker is also challenging any pneumatology that associates spirit with the world beyond, in which spirit is essentially identified with obscure actions or events that are not grounded in real life. He himself calls his spirit pluralistic and realistic. What he means thereby is that spirit is about specificity and understandability, and thus concreteness. The spirit activates our sensitivity to where life is lived, there where threats and challenges reside, where life is being compromised, and in particular, where liberation and deliverance is being sought, their spirit appears. He considers himself postmodern in the sense that his vantage point is pluralistic. He considers such pluralism as biblical, but understood more implicitly in what I would say evolutionarily. His template is John 3:5, which I just referenced earlier. The wind blows where it will, and we hear the sound thereof, but we do not know where it comes from or where it is going. But so is everyone who is born of the Spirit. Now, this does not say that spirit is determinate or fuzzy, but rather that spirit works for deliverance there where we hardly know where or why it is happening. The spirit brings an unexpected unanimity for the people of God, which frees them from the consequences of their powerlessness and brings them out of isolation. But the most surprising and vital aspect of Welker's perspective is his challenging the notion that Pentecost is primarily about union or unity. Rather, he insists that spirit champions plurality and diversity and what I would call depth. What he means thereby is that God's Spirit is not a papering over difference, but bringing out the differences for the sake of God's mercy and God's holiness. God's holiness and righteousness is not for the purpose of perfection, but to awaken us to the illusions and masks that are being lived out in our lives, perhaps in destructive form. Welker is not trumpeting a privatized particularity, but about what he calls individualistically disintegrative pluralism. He sees individualism as the enemy of pluralism because it does not operate from life-enhancing integrative pluralism of spirit. If we are seeking to avoid the reductionism of spiritual privatization, in other words, my private spirituality, where might we look for more holistic, spirit-visible awareness to come from? The biblical witness at Pentecost may offer us some clues. The messianic vision affirms God's pouring out of the Spirit on all flesh in the service of their liberation. The Spirit does so from within diverse contexts, communities, and persons to set the captives free. Thus, the work of liberating spirit becomes an essential ingredient in any context where the quest of freedom awakens. This is not a heroic action where spirit rises up in glory or victory. Spirit awakening is mostly accompanied by an intensification of the distress and its corresponding suffering. The eternal work of liberation does not come via magic or some act of aggression. Rather, it restores the internal structure and creates a capacity to see things in a new way, not only in their fragmentation and alienation, but in their potential cohesion. This is not automatically given, however, but the descent of spirit is an act of gathering, a joining together of persons who find themselves in distress. This discernment of spirit presupposes that God's Spirit does not mediate clear, immediate, unambiguous knowledge, but a growing clarity, a recognition of the grace, the awareness, and the mercy that lifts the chains operating in situations of insecurity and paralysis. Even in situations where there is no way out, the Spirit acts as comforter, namely the power that brings steadfastness in a state of affliction. The restoration of an internal structure creates the strength and capacity to see things as they really are, but not simply in their fragmented or alienated form, but in their potential new direction. In psychological language, we could perhaps call this a kind of reframing. Yet Welker insists that the caution is in order. He resists the reliance on the Holy Spirit as the so-called third person of the Trinity. At first blush, that sounds like a heretical statement. His critique arises from our Western vantage point, in which we identify personhood with what has been called expressive individualism, namely, to think of ourselves and the nature of God in individualistic terms. Welker's corrective is to suggest that we think of God's Spirit not as an individual person, but more along the lines of what he calls a public person. When a person is thought of only as an individual center of action, the full meaning of Spirit is truncated. If we only operate from the point of view of expressive individualism, we arrive at personhood understood as self-certainty, self-possession, self-production. What this seriously overlooks is that the Spirit of God invites us into conscious solidarity of love and responsibility in a mutuality. We are not awakened by and for ourselves. I would add, as growing from his point, the Holy Spirit is not a selfie. You can take that with you as well. As awakened by Spirit, we can accept our finitude and our perishability and can perceive our social significance and responsibility in full view of the innate dignity and worth of our fellow creatures. We become persons in spirit mode because we operate from what he calls a domain of resonance. What he means thereby is that we are formed as persons by and through a web of relationships. We are persons and become persons through waves of relatedness, as children of our parents, parents of our children, partners to our partners, friends of our friends, and contemporaries with our contemporaries. But even within this relational mix, we are never fully explained or fully known as a unity of person in our external mode. We can certainly operate as a center of action in the world, but our innermost self is never fully defined or exhausted by our exteriority. Why not? It is because we too are spirit and remain mystery, finite yet free, but profoundly shaped by webs of resonance, yet forging our own response to that resonance. Yet the person of Christ and the person of Spirit are not a unified blob. The Holy Spirit reveals a rupture even in that unity, the abandonment of the entire world and the stripping of resonance. Welker thus insists that we are compelled to face even the radical disjunction between the person of Christ and the person of Spirit, the ongoing ruptures of our world, the dismemberment of self and of other, and of our own complicity in dismemberment of our earth, drives us into that awareness. He says, yet Spirit too is present to every and all dismemberment. So what might this all mean for the praxis then of ministry? There is a spirit awakening that awaits us on the other side of dismemberment or decenteredness. Without in any way glibly promoting cheap grace, it requires a willingness to enter into the rigors of transformative praxis. It involves a sacrificial power and the spirit-given capacity for free self-withdrawal, freely given love, and the commitments that come from forgiveness. The presence of Holy Spirit acts within the liberations and entrapments of our brokenness. They reside within our states of alienation, whether personally or structurally given. Thus, Sacred Spirit becomes known as a saving public person in the Spirit's global visibility and recognizability. Spirit is both personal and global. If you could imagine for a moment what color spirit would be, I would offer green. There's an ecology of spirit that has been a faint but consistent echo throughout the biblical era, but now it seems to be virtually screaming in our ears. The ecological crisis is fully upon us. The theological answers for the 20th century don't seem to fully be able to hold and have sufficient power to address the full range of Spirit's demands upon us for the 21st century. Critical voices such as Sally McFaig in Body of God, an Ecological Theology, and Mark Wallace, The Green Face of God, demand of us a healing response to the earth. This is a very different theology than the skewed Genesis narratives that have reinforced the subjugation or denial of responsibility toward the earth. We know we live in the age of spirit when we find common cause between native Aboriginal peoples, scientists, modern pagans, Pope Francis, and a host of others. I would venture to say that we are in a contemporary Pentecost. Pentecost is now. Talk about unity and diversity. I believe that the first Pentecost participants would recognize that same spirit at work. We all don't talk the same language, nor do we draw from identical ideologies, but we share the unity of spirit that informs our actions and guides our care for the earth. Mark Wallace says, could it be that the most compelling response to the threat of ecocide lies in the recovery of Holy Spirit as a natural living being that indwells and sustains all life forms? Could it be that an earth-centered revisioning of the Spirit as the green face of God in the world is the best hope for renewal at a point in human history when our appetites seem destined to destroy the earth. Elizabeth Johnson, writing in Woman, Earth, and Creator Spirit, we find in her a vital fusion of ecological awareness and feminist consciousness. I have named dualism as a persistent nemesis for spirit blossoming, and this predominant and persistent hierarchical dualism has harmed Christian theology. It has contributed to the exploitation of nature, of women, of sexuality, and of the body. Sexism, in its Christian forms, has provided cover for this exploitation. The image of God as Imago Dei is not reflected in souls living apart from bodies, but consists of men and women in their wholeness, in their full communion with one another, and in their full sexual integrity. Our sexuality is a great superhighway of the spirit and includes the diversity of LGBT identities and other paths as another path to Pentecost. Who could imagine a few short years ago, that spirit would blow so consistently and compellingly in this direction, and that we too could be invited to the table? We are still on that road to Pentecost, but we can now be part of the advance party. Spirit needs people who are willing to set the table. In tracing the emergent awareness of sacred spirit through history, we have good grounds for perceiving Holy Spirit as a procession, as a river of life. In moving forth as a continuous dynamic process, we participate in this movement. Spirit is the life-giving creative energy at work in history, permeating all things, not only in birthing and transforming faith communities and their living spiritualities, but the full work of creation, redemption, and the sacralization of all of life. The seeming inevitable dualisms we have been struggling with, I would say, can now be addressed through Holy Spirit's visible participation. And I would like to affirm these conclusions that are basically summing up what I am trying to affirm in my presentation today. First of all, we must take immanence and transcendence seriously. God's Spirit must be perceived as present in all creation and in all people. Secondly, God's Spirit is vulnerable. God's Spirit exposes God's self even to the ravages of nature and history. God's Spirit as love comprehensively affirms relationality, which presupposes the capacity and the willingness to suffer, to be in solidarity with. This willingness to suffer links the Spirit to affect, to authentic feeling, and to a passion for union and participation. This mystical unitive path has been a prime carrier of the expressive, active, feeling dimension of the human bond with the sacred. True unity, thus, is not accomplished without participation in diversity, and diversity cannot find its connectedness without spirit's unitive capacity. Liberation theology captured the theological imagination many decades ago, but found strong resistance within the church because of its perceived militancy and seeming political overtones. But balanced theological voices such as Moltmann, Welker, Johnson, and others, many others, invite us not to turn our backs on the spirit awakening power of liberation, precisely because it emerges out of the historical experiential foundation of life. By focusing on real people, real histories, real narratives, theology rises from that place and becomes grounded. We can no longer afford to separate the secular from the salvific, creation from redemption, nor from the interweaving of grace in nature. Therefore, the reenchantment of nature and the earthling need to proceed together. Among the central invitations of that spirit-infused liberation theology that can activate that is an awareness of the oppressions of poverty in our world. An obvious form thereof, of course, is economic of patterns of exploitation in which persons are trapped in limitless cycles of marginalization. Surely the cry of justice rings not only on earth but also in heaven. But there's also in our world poverty of spirit, which scars its sufferers with the shallowness of mind, a reduction of spirit to its materialistic form and also traps its victims through chronic narrowness, blindness to neighbor, and chronic states of alienation and hierarchical oppression. If a fundamental spirit activity is the intention of liberation, how do we join its efforts? The answer is quite direct, namely that we must join the narratives of freedom journeys and their absences. Moltmann talks about the liberating work of spirit in three dimensions, which I'm trying to highlight here as my final point. Through liberating faith, liberating hope, and liberating love and liberating hope. The pathway to freedom must have experiential bases. There where suffering is lived, there resides a rupture, an estrangement that lives within and around any state of entrapment. The first form of freedom, therefore, must be the freedom of speech, of finding voice. Finding voice means it must be heard. The Belgian theologian Joseph Comblain makes the startling assertion that no one can make anyone else free. At first glance, we want to protest. What do you mean? We cannot assist others in their liberation journeys. What is he getting at? His insistence is that we must realize that freedom comes first and foremost from within, not outside. This is why we must follow the pastoral precept, we are heard into speech. The acts of deep listening awaken in the hearer a resonance with one's own inner unspoken voice. The as yet unformed vocalization of one's truth crystallizes into the speech that heretofore has been too hard or too crusted over to articulate. This vocalization is more than insight or being able to say, aha, that fits for me, or it sounds right. It is more like the felt rightness that allows harder truths to emerge. Often our suffering is the wedge, the lever, that pries open the oyster where the pearl resides, where the friction itself is produced. This is the interaction of spirit where the formerly unnameable breaks free. The intensity of it often forces the affect, the feeling out of us, either in lament or ecstasy. The second pathway to freedom is the experience of community. If Pentecost is anything, it is discovery of an unexpected community. The historical enmity toward the other bleeds through all of history. Brother against brother, clan against clan, tribe against tribe, nation against nation. At Pentecost, those absolute boundaries come down. But at the same time, the Spirit calls forth the resurrection, also calls forth a new relatedness among the divergent communal identities. When they accepted Spirit's call, they did not lose their identities, their clothing, their languages, their cultures, their ways of being. Their distinctions were not obliterated, but harmonized into a tapestry. In our day, the pressure on uniformity, on like-mindedness, runs counter to the Pentecost call to diversity. This diversity reaches deep, not narrow or thin. Our age experiences the spirit awakenings of gender diversity, of fluidity of identity, and the value norms that so often collide in our world. Pentecost continues the call from our Creator for a fuller humanity fashioned in the Spirit of God in its rich multiplicity. And lastly, and perhaps most importantly, I would like to speak of the spirit journey that I will call an ecological force field. The spirit visible in ecocentrism comes in various forms, creation spirituality, deep ecology, animal rights, Gaia, you name it. Reverence for the earth is a core affirmation of spirit, but it comes to us in crisis. There seems to be an urgency that of spirit's call to us. Perhaps first a prophetic call to repentance as our first act, but our stewardship toward the earth has become twisted into an exploitation of it. A seeming seizure of power over the earth. The cries of the earth may be its first form and seeks to reach out to us. Does the Spirit not awaken us to another mode of relatedness to the earth as a mode of God's being? Through the Spirit, God participates in our earthly destiny, and through Spirit, God suffers with us and all God's creatures within this destiny. We have gladly trumpeted the goodness of creation in our theologies by celebrating the onset of creation, but easily forget the anxious waiting of creation as the whole earth groans and suffers. Romans 8:22. If spirit and its earth internally permeate each other, then they are inseparable. Thus we can affirm with many others that earth is the body of the spirit. Just as God becomes human in the God person of Jesus Christ, God too enfleshes God's self as embodied reality of life on earth. This spirit fills the earth with the breath of life and offers sustenance to all things. Thank you.
Thanks so much, Bill. There is some time for conversation and discussion now, if anyone would like to ask a question or make a remark.
I've been totally blinded by the light, so I truly cannot see you, so I'm going to have to maybe move out of this. Move out over here. Okay. That's better.
Question or a remark, an observation, a rebuttal?
I was just wondering, you talked about the earth as the body of the spirit. What about the universe, the universe story? And wondering about the universe as being the body of the spirit.
I think I wanted to situate it very concretely in our lived experience, and the use of narrative, like to be able to allow the innate story to be lived out in its fullness, I think brings it closer to home. So I didn't want to sort of get too global. Now I think through contemporary science, you know, through cosmology and so on, there's some really absolutely fascinating thing, theological implications that grow from these things. And so there's really, that would be another whole presentation, but I wanted to sort of keep our feet on the ground in that way. Okay.
More comments or questions? Mike will come to you.
What I was hoping to do, just to kind of flesh out my own searching, is to allow the Spirit of God a full measure in participatory experience. In other words, that yes, understood, the earth is God's body, but that it's a lived and a dynamic process. So I want to make an appeal to dynamism and to lived a living God that's present to all things. The Jesuits have a wonderful phrase that they use. It's part of our banners and stuff. God in all things. And that's a, I would say, a pretty profound affirmation that my own spiritual journey holds. God in all things.
I have a question, though.
Yeah.
If two parts, I guess. One is, can you say a couple of things about what disrupts either our awareness of the light of the Spirit or our ability to receive that light? And secondly, is there, and this is a little more pointed, is there a way in which pilgrimage disrupts those disruptions?
Yeah, oh, that's great, yeah.
So either one, or both, if you like.
Again, maybe the affirmations of a Jesuit spirituality, one of the prime notions in that spirituality is discernment. And the work of discernment is the work of sorting out the internal and the external processes of our lives and in our context. So we're never removed, or the responsibility for discernment is never lifted from us. So that presumes that when we have to do discernment, there's ambiguity. In other words, there's always some tension that's having to be worked out. So I think one of the ways in which we sort of drifted into a sort of an unconsciousness is we feel like we don't necessarily have to engage the tougher questions of our lives or our cultural lived contexts. So the work of discernment is an absolute gift of the Spirit that invites us into these more ambiguous, troubling, challenging themes in our lives. So the embrace of ambiguity would be kind of, I would say, even a gift of spirit. So when we think about, let's say, having a troubled conscience, you know, you can't sleep at night, you're preoccupied. There may be a seed of spirit reflection, a spirit invitation in that restlessness. So to trust our inner restlessness, that we are joined in that process. So it's a kind of a mystical vision, I would say, but a very radical participatory vision. And I think ministry can be profoundly supported and sustained in that awareness, meaning that our efforts of discernment aren't alone. So, and even as I meet another's challenges in discernment, I presume the Spirit is also working from within that deep source in that person or in that community. And so it's a mutuality of discernment, which I think strengthens the whole body of Christ in its mutual effort. But you are asking about pilgrimage as a kind of a pro, or you know, does pilgrimage take us away or move us toward?
Yeah.
That was part two. You know, a lot of things in life offer us escapist possibilities or deepening possibilities. So, you know, even as when you embark on something as noble, we could call it, as a pilgrimage, there are plenty of distractions and plenty of things you can divert yourself with. So even on the Camino, those of you who were here yesterday, I talked a little bit about my Camino experience as a pilgrim. On the pilgrimage, I had many, many temptations, and I'll share a couple of them with you. Okay, I'll start with this one. I love Leonard Cohen, okay? And I've always wanted to hear him live. And he came to Chicago, maybe, I don't know, 10 years ago or 15 years ago, and for some reason I missed it. I just couldn't forgive myself that I had missed that opportunity. And then there was another occasion where I was somewhere else, and I didn't get there. Something came in the way. So I'm walking on the Camino, and I get to Lyon, a big city. I get there early in the afternoon, and I'm walking around and go to the tourist center, and lo and behold, there's a big sign: Leonard Cohen is in Lyon. It's within walking distance. There are tickets available. What do you think I did? Anyone want to guess? I turned it down. And the reason I turned it down was it would have been a distraction. And I knew enough that I was, at that point in the journey, I had sort of aligned myself enough that I was not in a place where I needed entertainment. That wouldn't have been a transformative process for me at that point. I was so deeply immersed in the process that so that allows me to say, pilgrimage is really not a vacation. It's not time out. It is sort of time out, but it's not it's not escapist. So entering into the full ambiguities of your life takes discipline and a willingness, a consciousness around that. It can be accidental. I mean, we can back into transformative challenges, and often our awakenings, frankly, come in that way. I think most of us back into pilgrimage that way, and then we realize, oh yeah, I need to choose something that's going to move my life along, kind of thing. So yeah, I had several temptations on the Camino. Yes.
More questions or comments?
Yes. Oh, sorry.
I'm just wondering about the element of fear that comes. You are deeply into this walk and this transformation. How do you account for the fear that develops? I mean, even entering into a busy section of Lyon or wherever he was would conjure up emotions.
Yeah, yeah.
And where does that take you?
That's great. Yeah, that's great.
What's that supposed to do?
Sure, okay. You know, all of us, me too, have our own particular fear-like pattern where fear tends to reside. I'm generally not a fearful person in terms of like launching out into, you know, exploring things, and I've been a hiker for much of my life, and so launching into the Camino wasn't fear producing in terms of getting lost and things, and also it's also so very well marked. I mean, I did get lost twice. If you read my book, you know, I got distracted, and you know, the markers are there, but you have to pay attention. If you're not paying attention, you're, and then an hour or two later, I was completely, I didn't know where I was, in the middle of nowhere. But it wasn't like panic. Where fear resided for me was more moving into some painful issues in my life. And because I knew I was there for that purpose, it's in a way I sort of chose to move into the fear. And so that's, I think, an important insight I would want to offer anyone, is at some point, we're going to be invited to move into our fear, move toward it. Whatever that is for you, you know, you may choose to outrun it. You may try and outrun it, but it'll nip at your heels. So at some point, you'll have to turn and face the monster, whatever that is. It could be a wound, you know, a personal, emotional wound, or anything. And we all have that fear center. So one of the ways in which I think pilgrimage, it's as a structured experience, as a held experience, allows us to fortify ourselves for the fear that will come. Now, I offer the parallel of Jesus' narrative in the wilderness. I call that moving into the fear center. Okay? And you know there's a reason why that is held in such high regard in our Christian tradition as his transformative pilgrimage. You know, his entry into the wilderness was his necessary transformational journey. He couldn't, his mission, his ministry was built on that experience. So often our ministries are based on our entry into the inner, into the wilderness that we carry. So, and we need help around that. Now, he also, you know, Jesus had the, you know, he had the, in the narrative, he had the help that he needed, even as limited as he, you know, he was totally exposed in terms of living or dying and the forces, psychological, spiritual forces he was fighting with. But he was nevertheless held in some fashion in that process.
Thanks, Bill. So you talked about eliminating dualisms, but how do we deal with this particular kind of dualism? So yesterday you were talking about the power of the unconscious, and unconscious structures imprison people. Most of the dark monsters that we spoke of, they work out there. And the total unconscious we get, many of us are subject to those unconscious structures. Pilgrimage, good spiritual practice, good therapeutic journeys should bring us to a place of freedom, ultimately, where we're no longer controlled by those forces. Right. And so we're looking for freedom. Absolutely.
Right.
Period. To be free. Great. Absolutely free. Sign of hell. However, you also, in the story by our comment, were bound.
Yes.
You weren't free.
Yes.
Right? So how do you deal with those kinds of dualisms? On one hand, and we're replete with it in our spiritual practice. On one hand, we want freedom, but you were bound to Jesus. We're bound to holy life, right? Which, so it creates this lovely tension.
Yeah.
Do you comment on those? Because you've got to be disciplined, you're bound to something when you're in pilgrimage, and yet you're seeking freedom.
Yeah. I think freedom is not an unbounded reality. In other words, it's not anything goes. You know, it's not without horizon. So the freedom comes in embracing the authentic horizon, whatever that might be. So sometimes we don't recognize these until after the fact. You know, so it's not so self-evident. And sometimes we stumble around in our unfreedom for a lot longer than maybe we wish we could had, but I think because as spirit, we're a spirit, it's open, and it's never defined or fixed. So there's always new potential for oppression or losing one's way, and so it's an open horizon. So we're actually meant to live into the vulnerability that's coming at us that isn't even here yet. Right? So let's talk about the dynamics of aging, or no matter, you know, whatever's going on in the world, and so on. So there's more stuff coming at us all the time. So there's always more to integrate, right? There's always more to have to take on, take in, work through, and so on. So I think it's more allowing freedom to come into the service of a kind of a harnessing of the most authentic place you find yourself. Realizing it's even the space that you inhabit is transient. You know, you're on the way. You're a person on the way, and you're never going to be off the way. So, you know. Oh no.
When I hear an expression like reverencing creation, it seems to me that the pilgrimage spirituality that you're describing has a deep sense of interconnectedness of everything in the spirit. And when I, in my own experience, I've seen a lot of opposition to embracing that kind of thinking.
Sure.
Where, in your experience, are the biggest signs of hope that that the kind of spirituality that you are describing is beginning to be embraced more and more?
Well, I think, you know, I don't know if it's universally true, but, you know, I consider myself part of the older generation. Often when younger generation emerges, we tend to sort of feel like, oh, we're going to hell in a handbasket. You know, things are just, you know, so much worse than they always, you know, now than they used to be, kind of thing. I don't hold it that way. I sort of see the vibrancy in young people as a very dynamic spirit invited. I think spirit invites all creatures into their fullest capacity that they have at any given time. And so I sort of trust that. I have an implicit trust that the spirit is working even in the detours. And when resistance comes, I think it's the nature of freedom too, of openness. In other words, persons, communities, cultures, relationships fall into their disintegration. So there's a disintegration potentiality that's through the gift of freedom that we can lose our way. So I try not to fret over that so much. Like we can lose our, and that's one of the risks in ministry is that we sort of end up taking on more than we can. So that's an occupational hazard in terms of burnout and thinking we have it, we need to do it all, or so we sort of lose trust of the process sometimes. So I think pilgrimage is one good way to learn trusting the process within oneself, first of all, and then in a wider way. So I hope I haven't turned you all off on pilgrimage. It's the only way. It's the only way.
Well, we've come to the end of this pilgrimage, though I think it's the beginning of many other journeys for us. So I want to say, we'll hold our thanks to, yesterday we started with a thanks to Bill, we'll end with a thanks to Bill. But I do want to thank a few other people who have been pivotal in this project. Marianne Martin, who does a lot of the back coordinating, arranges flights, arranges to get stuff done, and kind of keeps the agenda in front of the school about all the things that happen. She's our prime communicator with our lecturers and the field particularly. So she develops these relationships with our lecturers that I don't have. And everybody, all the lecturers, including Bill, the first thing Bill said to me, he said, well, I got to see Marianne. I have to meet Marianne. So yeah. Marianne Martin, thank you so much for all your work. So, Amy Lorenzi, thank you so much for your work. Technical stuff, good stuff up. Taping, getting Bill set up, making him feel comfortable. Thank you so very much. Those are the people kind of in the background who do lots of the work that make this thing fly. So thank you. Well done. So it's been a really lovely experience with you. Are there any, I don't know if there are any books left. Are they all sold? We have one left.
three left. We have three of Bill's books left. We started with 20. We're now down to three. So they're $20 each if people want to purchase a book. There's also refreshment afterwards, so feel free to spend some time here, ask Bill, talk to Bill about his experiences, if you have any other questions that came up. So there are some light refreshments just across the hall, so please, you're welcome to be a part of that as well. Let's see, the next thing. Evaluation forms are here too, so we really appreciate the evaluations. And if you have thoughts about future lecturers, people that would benefit. Bill's already said I'd love to come back to Nova Scotia. We'd love to have him back too. So if you have thoughts about people who may come, who would be wonderful Nicolson lectures, please let us know that too. Thank you for spending time with us. Bill has taken us on an extraordinary journey. It's about pilgrimage. But one of the vital dimensions of it is the courage to take those steps, to recognize there's something askew, something that's off. And I think when we look at the history of pilgrims, they knew that something had to be done, that something had to change, and they had the courage to take those steps, to make those changes. And the beautiful thing that Bill has illustrated for us both psychologically and theologically is that we don't know what the outcome is going to be. There are no guarantees. Except that by taking those steps, we find ourselves in a place of greater freedom, greater vulnerability, greater courage. And for the last 2 days, we've had that experience with Bill. So on behalf of Atlantic School of Theology and with these two small envelopes, Bill, thank you so very much for being with us.
Thank you. Thank you.
Thank you all.